I'm sorry. Yes, your midterm is going to cover the material from chapter 1 all the way to chapter 13. So you're not responsible for the rest of the chapters on your midterm, and this is the only book that this is the only book that you need for your midterm. The next book is Get Started On It. Definitely, please do get started on it. Get then you can start the plan. The first chapter on it. We're going to start on actual thematic issues. Next week, we're going to address English in the world. We're going to address the conversation in English. It's going to say issues, what was English before, how is English now, what is English, how is English different in different areas of the world, in different geographic locations. The European may not address all these issues. But I'd like to, also be sure to you by next time to have all the questions. So that you start to try to disseminate information, start thinking about it, start why you're reading. You were asking me last time, you were asking me this 10 minutes ago that should we start preparing for the end. You need to read the chapters, So before you do about the first four chapters, before you read the first four chapters, what is the end of it about? So that while you're reading, you take that opportunity and take notes. Now, I need to make sure.
Sometimes you will find it, you will refer to a journal. So I need to talk about all of these things
Like it's first line or it's seen, she's seen who are not action verbs. There's nothing that is happening. I'm just describing a state of being, a state of the mind, a state of descriptive state. So usually I can replace these verbs by the verb to be, and the sentence would be perfectly fine. So I'm not adding any participants, I'm using them to describe a state. These verbs are going to be followed, as we said earlier, by a complement. Remember the passive voice? When can I form the passive? When I have an object. When I have an object. If I have an object and I want to change the purpose of the sentence from its subject to a new subject, to a different subject, to a different participant in the clause, she drops the pen, the pen was dropped. Now my interest now has changed from who dropped the pen to what was dropped, so I form that. I use the passive. The pen was dropped. Now the topic, the subject of the clause is the old object. Then we talked about joining clauses together. How can we join clauses? What are the two ways of joining clauses?
Coordination and subordination.
Under coordination and subordination, we have coordinate coordinators and subordinators, and these are the ones that are called conjunctions. What's the difference between coordination and subordination? Co-coordination. Yes. Co-independent clauses, they're equal status clauses. So she talks and they listen. She talks, they listen. She wrote, but she listened. Now these are co-independent clauses, they can stand alone. Whereas the subordination, one independent and the other dependent. Because she practiced, she knows the terminology. So because she practiced, can she encounter? It's subordinate, it's less independent than she knows the answer or she understands the concept. It depends on it, that's why we call it subordinate, and it starts with a subordinator, such as because, such as when, before, after, or so, if. The girl that, the book that we bought, the book that we bought is interesting. And our subordinator here is quite large. What is my subordinator? That. It's a different type of subordination. I'm now including a clause within a clause. I'm not having one of the independent clause and one dependent clause out of the subordinator, but it is still ideal. It is still a subordinated clause, it's still a dependent clause, so it cannot stand on its own. That we bought is not independent, it's a dependent clause, something that cannot stand on its own. This leads us to chapter 9, where we talk about the clause in general, but basically we take one part of the clause. One part of the clause is the verb phrase. So I'm talking about the clause that starts, that any clause. She likes apple juice. She likes apple juice. What do I have in this clause?
Subject.
So I want to say the element. Subject,
verb,
and object. What is the subject?
She.
What is the verb? Like and? So, I have a verb. This verb can be one word, she likes, or she has really enjoyed, she has enjoyed her apples. It can be a number of words. But I can use, she may like apples. I can use more than to modify a verb, to give possibility about the possibility of the action of the verb. She is writing her homework. So that's the point. Where she was ING talking about something that is in progress. She was given a new task. What's that? She was given a new task. To form what? She was given a new task. That's the point. So I can indicate the title. I can definitely remember elements for that are verb to be, verb to have, verb to participle, but basically I can express
program.
So if you look at this next,
if you think of any sentence, she likes a country, this sentence is in which sense? Which sense can I use it in? Which sense can I use this special same idea other than the we want to talk about verbs is that some verbs, as we mentioned earlier, can be copied. They bring the bread home, they go to the bread home, they gave her a book, they control the volume, they share knowledge. These verbs, they copy. They are transferred into other participants. The subject has an influence on the action form of another participant of the object. When a verb doesn't say an object, it is the word in fashion. For example, he sends. He sends. He sends. Sends up. He stood up. So these verbs that don't say an object are called in fashion. The third type of verb is the copular verb. Now the copular verb is a verb that follows, that is followed by a complement. A copular verb, as we described it, the verb is a verb describes an action. A copular verb describes the same thing and does not add any function. So you look kind of tired, the cake, smells delicious. The salesman is an engineer. No participant, no action. It feels, smells delicious, he's tidy. I can say she feels tidy. I have, I talk about transitive verbs, I talk about intransitive verbs, I talk about subordinate verbs, and then we can, in the verb phrase, we have different elements. As we mentioned earlier, we have the modern element, we have the perfect element, the progressive element, and the passive element. Let me give you this example and tell me if you can identify the different elements. I have the verb list, and I'm saying, she is with my verb.
So as we said earlier, we have two tenses in English specifically.
we have different elements within the verb change. We have the modal, we have the perfect form, we have the progressive, the passive elements. If they occur together, or if two of them occur together, or three, they would occur in this order. Modal first, perfect next, progressive, then passive. I have two tenses, past and present, and I have two aspects, the progressive and the perfect. Any questions about this? Any? Do you know the different types of verbs? Do you know the different elements of a verb phrase, the different possible elements of a verb phrase? Now, if we look at the activity related to chapter 9, I would like you to actually give this activity a shot because it addresses all of the skills that we, all of the concepts and all of the terms that we were talking about. In a real text situation, it's a real excerpt from, it's a text from a real conversation, from a real place, a real story. So let's look at this paragraph and let's identify, as activity 9.1 is asking us, which of the verbs that are here is a finite verb. So we're going to have a lot of verbs. Some of them are finite, some of them are non-finite. Let's identify the finite ones. The forest was very busy the day before winter. Was? Is it finite? You're saying no. How come? How do I decide if it's finite or not? If it changes time, can I say is busy? Was busy? I can change it. I can change the tense. It doesn't indicate the tense. It is the past tense here. Except one little squirrel named Ernest. He was very lazy and very fat because he sat in his bed all day eating cake. Fat? Was is a finite verb. What else?
Eating.
Is eating finite here?
Non-finite.
It doesn't have a tense. Because I could say he sat in his bed all day happy. He sat in his bed all day lazy. He sat lazy in his bed. I can change it with an adjective here. It doesn't have a tense. I don't talk about eating now or eating before. It's not a verb. What other verbs, finite verbs, do I have? I'm sorry. Sat, and what else? No, I'm still within that same sentence. Do I have anything? Is named finite or non-finite? Non-finite. The squirrel, one little squirrel named Ernest, called Ernest, with the name Ernest. That's what it says. It doesn't have a sense to it. Eating, again, the same thing. It's non-finite. He lived in a blackberry bush. What tense is it? Past tense. Okay, now I'm going to move to the next activity. You know how to go about it. Please do look at this and test your knowledge by checking this activity. Here we're talking about analyzing the verb phrase. Can you see the board well? Alright. So we're talking here about analyzing the sentences, but basically, specifically the verb phrase. I'm going to isolate everything. I'm going to isolate the verb phrase out of the class. And see what elements of the verb phrase exist. She was wearing a coat and a hat. Where is the verb phrase? Was wearing. What elements can I identify? Progressive, where? Where would I mark the progressive form?
Was.
Now I could do the ing if I'm underlining it, but by clicking it will click on all of wearing. What is wearing? It's the lexical part, was wearing. The neighbors might be coming later. Might is what? Mother. B is progressive. And coming is lexical. Great. Any worries about that? You have been shouting at me all morning. Let's take one more. I've been shouting. Does it have a tense? Is it finite or non-finite? It's finite. It does have a tense, right? So have been shouting. What do we have here? Perfect. Have. Progressive. Been. the lexical element is the shouting. So I'm glad you're okay with that. You look like you have really grasped it. It looks easier with the activity. That's why, I mean, these activities are priceless, honestly. You look at it and it might look easier, it might look a little bit more complicated, but I think you need to know which part I'm not able to identify. Which part is ambiguous to me? Is it a little bit confusing? I look at it and I practice it. So, if it's easier to see it on a sentence, that's great. That means you've understood it, actually. So let me look at this activity. This is kind of an interesting activity. Again, they're talking about finite and non-finite, but this same conversation, this same dialogue is going to be used for the other exercises. So let's look at it. Oranges and lemons, say the bells of St. Clement. Oranges and lemons, say the bells of St. Clement. Where is my verb phrase? Say, is it finite or non-finite? Can I say said? I can say said. I can use it in the past, so it has a sense to it. I served your mother at the airport and she remembered my name. Sir? Remembered. I wasn't even wearing my name tag. Wasn't. I could identify wearing or I don't have to. Okay, so you know what is finite and what is not. Now we're going to take these same sentences and we're going to label the sentence with the different elements of a clause. What are the different elements of a clause? Oranges and lemons say the bells of St. Clement. Oranges and lemons, what would you label that? Subject. Anybody disagrees with that? Why did you say subject? It's the beginning. So what's the normal word order? An English subject, verb, object. Now, usually that's a very logical conclusion. Just look at the meaning a little bit here. Oranges and lemons say the bells of St. Clement. Who's doing the saying? The bells. The bells are saying. So exceptionally here, I'm going to have a subject, the bells of St. Clement, and a verb. And what do they say? The object. What do they say is the object? Oranges and lemons. Now, I served your mother at the airport. Subject. Verb. Object. At the airport. Adverbial. What question is the adverbial answering here? Where did you see her? Okay. I wasn't wearing my name tag even. Subject. Verb. Object. My name tag. And adverb is even. Okay, let me skip a couple and go down to number 6. I'm very proud at your mother remembering your, at my mother remembering your name. Are you the subject? Verb? Compliment. It's a compliment, you're right. Why is it a compliment? Because it follows a popular verb. It's not a new participant. It's not a new participant, okay. So, she gets extremely interested. She is a subject. Compliment, again. Compliment. She gets interested. She is happy. She gets interested. She gets excited. So I'm describing, I'm adding new information to the subject. Now, you're right about the idea that sometimes it can be similar in format to the adverbial, but if I cannot do away with it, if it's essential to the sentence, such as she gets interested. Can I say she gets? If I say she walks quickly, I can do away with the adverbial, do away with quickly, and the sentence would still have meaning, but I'm adding something with the adverbial. I'm answering when, where, how, and why. But here, yes, I'm answering what happens to her, but I'm actually, or how is she, but I cannot do away with it. This is an essential part, and it's following a popular verb, so it's going to be my complement in this sentence. So this is, I mean, there are other examples. Do this exercise and see if you are unclear about any of them. Now we have the exact same sentences, and now it gets really easy, actually. Now, if you know this, I mean, you've covered chapter 9. You have labeled it, and they have put the labels that you put on. Oranges and lemons say the bells of St. Clement. Now we know where the verb is, or the verb phrase is. Is the verb transitive, intransitive, or copular? Why? There's an object. I served your mother at the airport. Transitive. I wasn't wearing my name tag. Everybody agrees it's transitive? Anybody this? Okay. There is an object. Exactly. It should be as simple as that. If there is an object, then it's transitive. Why did you pause? There's too many transitive verbs. All right. You might be coming home. Intransitive. You owe me 5 farthings. Transitive. I'm very proud of your mother remembering my name. It's not intransitive. It has no action in it. I walk, I come. That's an intransitive verb here. It's a copular verb. We've already said it takes a complement. So when I have a complement, I have a copular verb. When I have a copular verb, I have a complement. They go together. She gets extremely interested. Copular again. I've got a 3-month visa waiver. Transitive, I have an object. Okay, so rule of thumb, if I have an object, then that's it. No matter how many transitive verbs I have, don't stop, don't get worried that you've got too many transitive verbs. Let me take one more. Your picture looks so sunny and warm. Is it intransitive or copular? I would call it a copular verb because your picture is so funny and warm. It looks so funny and warm. As opposed to I look at something, which is an intransitive verb. So look can go both ways. I look at the window or I look out of the window, that's an intransitive verb. But when I say it looks funny, it looks something, it means it is something. It seems it's a copular verb. So I'm glad you seem to be okay with that, because this is as simple as it is. You just have to identify finite and non-finite based on whether it has a tense or not, it has a time or not, and you need to be able to identify transitive, non-transitive, copular, and the different elements of a verb phrase. Now, on chapter 10, we're letting go of the verb phrase a little bit. We go back to our original... We go back to that example of a clause that I had, and I bring it back here, put it where it is, and the clause has a noun phrase, a verb phrase, and another noun phrase. This is the example of my annoying neighbor lives in K. My annoying neighbor lives in K. Or she likes allergies. What do I have?
Now phrases, name, things, and everything.
Noun phrases can be either subject, object, or complement. Now, in the book, they give you examples of noun phrases that occur not in a full clause, but in a list or in a menu. So I have on page 80, I think. On page 80, you have example of nouns or noun phrases on a menu. Hamburger, cheeseburgers, etc. So give us a list of things. You know, if you're shopping list, tomatoes, cucumbers, cheese, a naming element. So I have noun phrases in this, I have noun phrases in menus, I have noun phrases in advertisements, sale, big sale. Do you have your books open on page 18? 67, sorry. Page 67, look at the diamond shape, not the diamond shape, the square at the bottom. What is that called wood shape? It's a noun phrase. What is it talking about? What is the main noun in this noun phrase? So save or save, actually. So, monster is what? Monster cars won't save. So what is the name of a subject or something that calls to talk about? Subject is the name. It's a noun phrase. Now, monster as a word class is what? Adjective noun, verb.
Noun.
But how is it functioning here? Monster says, or monster car says, it's what you want. It's describing the main noun. The same thing can apply to, in this sentence, all my friends are watching the World Cup final tonight. I have a subject, I have a home, I have an object, I have a value. How many noun phrases do I have in this sentence? Two noun phrases. The word subfinal. Let's take them one by one. All my friends. What is the main noun? What is the noun of the noun? The head of the noun phrase. Exactly. What is the head of the noun phrase? It's friend. In the second one. Final. It's the word final. Now, on the final normally is the word class is an adjective, but here it's the head of the word class. It has turned into usually as a noun, the world. Stop final. We're watching the final. Now, look who I have here beside the noun, beside the head. What do I call the world, my? Maybe modifier, maybe not actually, because the three is right, because it comes before the noun. But in this case, let me actually start a little bit more accurately. When we have a noun, when we have a noun as a head of the class, I can have a pronoun, right? Instead of saying, the girl, the pretty girl is usually pronouns, she, they, I, we are, it's happening with somebody. When I have a noun, can I say girl that's the girl?
The girl.
The girl. Can I say girl that's the girl?
No.
Can I say girl that's the girl? Or girl that's the girl?
The girl.
I should have, usually I would have that. Can I say girl? Any girl can come, every girl is. So I'm asking something to identify, to determine the term, and this is what I call determiner. Now, determiners include articles, a and the, but they also include other terms. Now, these other points vary depending on whether I have some of the noun or uncompleted, and whether these terms of the noun are singular or they are plural forms. So if I have a singular noun, a girl, I can say a girl, the board, this pen, that window, where every man, any, I don't know, any eraser, one microphone. So I can use that with the count of the noun. I can use one and a because I can count them, one. Now I get to the count of the noun of the plural. Again, I can talk about the plural. I can say these pens, those pens, many pens, some, several, a few, enough, both, two, three, 50, 17. I can count them, but I can use numbers as a term. When I talk about other kinds of noun, such as heat, furniture, sugar, can I say these sugar? I can't use any of the plural ones. So when I talk about it in one, usually I will talk about some or much. Some sugar, much lot. So I talk and yet heat, enough heat. So I talk about I determine the noun, I specify the noun without specifying any number here. That's why we say the, but we don't use a or an, so we can't have any and no and none again. The general and another defining a number. So we use determiners. Sometimes we use the determiners which are the possessive pronouns as determiners also, such as all my friends. All my friends. So my is the determiner here. I define which group of friends. All my friends. Now this is in terms of determiners. But that's not all what happens. That's not all what we may have in terms of this, before a main noun, a head noun in an article. I can say the my new cotton shirt. My new cotton shirt. Cotton in principle is what? And the word class, the word cotton is what? No, use it as an adjective. And use it as an adjective, what it's a noun. Now look at this sentence. Stylish cotton uniform trousers. What do I have? I have three ones, and who are three ones? Where is the noun phrase? What is the head of that noun phrase? The pants. I'm talking about the trousers. How am I modifying them? With an adjective, with a noun, and another noun. So anything, whether nouns or adjectives, are used before the head to describe the head, to modify the head, I'm going to call three modifiers. Now three modifiers, I'm a determiner, and then three modifiers. If I have adjective and noun and a three modifier, what comes first? The adjective or the noun? The adjective. The noun is usually used to classify the item. So here when I say cotton, when I say uniform trousers or uniform pants, I'm classifying them. They're uniform pants, not another type of pants. So it's important, more fundamental than saying new, more fundamental than saying beautiful girl. So if I say, if I look at this example here, I can, we say we can use adjectives, a three modifier, and then what we use to, this pretty girl, my annoying neighbors, my annoying neighbors, etc. But I can also middle class business. Clever is an adjective, middle is an adjective, class is a noun. Important information about the student, he's a business student, not another kind of student. Here, the junior C5 report. Again, it's classifying the head. It's a C5 report, not a desert report, not a mountain report. So the noun adjective, the noun tree modifier is a little bit more fundamental than the adjective. Free modifier. The noun element is more fundamental. Now, this is when it comes to free modifiers. What about force modifier? Do I stop? Sometimes I say, be a new student who just walked into the class is my cousin. The new student who just walked into the class is my cousin. What is the noun phrase? The new student who just walked into the class is my cousin. And I stop. What is the new student just walked into the class? Again, what is the next phrase? Because I have noun as a subject and in the verb or the popular verb, and my cousin is what? Waiting in the corridor is a girl, not a girl, which girl? Not any girl, desired waiting in the toilet. First question. The verb must begin or the end. All the languages spoken in India. All the languages spoken in India. Chosen for the competition. So I can also modify that and describe it further by using the past participle after the end of the phrase.
Straightforward. You just have to get used to the names. Past participle, present participle, relative clauses, etc. Now, sometimes I don't have nouns, as we said. I don't have nouns as heads of the phrase, as heads of the nouns. I have pronouns. And usually, when I have pronouns, I have pronouns standing alone. She, they, we, he, she, it, they, we, you, I, and the pronoun. It's very nice. But I can modify it somewhere. Not as much as I can modify the noun, but I can modify the pronoun by adding a quantifier to show the pronoun. All of us, some of me, many of them, both of them, exactly. I use a quantifier determiner. That would quantify that, it's very how many. And sometimes it can be preceded by an adjective. Silly me. Crazy or you. When would I use such expression? In which time, in which situation? Conversation between friends and any kind of situation. I wouldn't say crazy or you or smart, even smart you. I wouldn't use that for me. Somebody comes to me, first somebody spoken in someone's language. Now, another thing that you can do with pronouns, and there are many things that you can do, you can talk about present participle. I can say, you reading your book, you looking out the window. I can use present participle. Or I can say, you in the back, you with a brown scarf. I can address somebody, I can. She will be something, or she in the corner, she at the front, she in the back. I can use it. This is very different. I can use it now. I can use it with pronouns. But most often than not, pronouns, how do they occur in a sentence? No, they occur in a noun phrase, they occur in a noun. So this is basically, these are basically the different ways in which we can modify a noun phrase, in which we can modify the head of the noun phrase. If the head can be what?
A verb?
A preposition? What's the head of a noun phrase?
The head of a noun phrase is usually what?
A
noun. A noun or what?
A
pronoun. It's a noun or a pronoun. The head is always going to be either a noun or a pronoun.
Now, remember, when we talked a minute ago about post-modifiers
being preposition phrases sometimes and the relative clauses of others, I can have a simple noun phrase that was girl or the girl, but I can go on and use a post-modifier, the girl whom we met. Normal post-modifier, but I can go on and on. I can have a string, a loop of post-modifier. The girl and whom we met in the park where we had our picnic, which was scheduled for Labor Day, that happened 2 days before. I can go in a loop of relative clauses. They call them in the book very interestingly, like Russian dogs. You know how Russian dogs, one dog goes into the other, into the other. Or I can talk about, for example, a loop of, or a string of
prepositional phrases. The bench in the park near the bakery under the dancing studio on 12th Street in New York City. I can keep going on and on. Now, these complex noun phrases can cause some trouble. They make the small definition more complex. That's straightforward. I have to keep track, okay, of the many different things that I'm describing in the head. Another thing, it may create ambiguity. In what sense? Take this sentence here.
the girl, this clause, sorry, this phrase, the noun phrase. The girl with the pink bag at the front of the classroom. What do I have here? Where's the head? The girl?
Yeah.
The girl, okay. And what modifiers do I have? With the pink bag. At the front of the classroom. Now look at the front of the classroom. What is it modifying? What is it modifying? The you say the pink bag, she's saying the girl, it can be understood as the pink bag is at the front of the classroom, or the bag is at the front of the classroom, or the girl is at the front of the classroom. So when I have more than one post modifier, especially of the same size, sometimes it creates complex noun phrases, can create ambiguity in the reference of the modifier. Now this is one. Another thing, remember yourself writing when your sentence goes along, the girl who is friends with my classmate and who has a lot of tasks to accomplish, and you want to get to the verb now. Or are. Life or life? How do I agree? With what subject do I agree? Where do I go back? I need to always go back to the head of the noun, whether it's a pronoun or a noun. So sometimes it kind of creates some confusion about subject verb concord or subject verb agreement. For the simple practical of this agreement that is too far away. The subject is too far away from its verb, I use track of the verb. Can you, do you remember yourself doing that sometimes when you write? You write a long sentence and like, what should I put now? It's singular or plural. Or you read it later on and you say, oh, I should have changed that. Why? Because you lose track of the main verb, and that's exactly what we're talking about here. I mean, a simple example, the players who are responsible for winning the game and who met with a famous reporter, study at our university. Not studies, although reporter is closest to the verb, but I don't care about the word reporter. I care about the head, which is
the
player here, the player. So this is as simple as it is. Now, I've just given another example here. I've minimized the poor verb phrase because our question can't understand it on the noun phrase. So I put it just on the side in the corner. The noun phrase. Basically, it is a determinant, can have a determinant, three modifiers, head, and the head is either a noun or a pronoun, followed by a post modifier. Now, I included one inside a post modifier, which is a sentence, but you can think of a lot of other times. There is an example here. Look at this example here of the three modifier alone. We have examples. I mean, open any book while you're reading any of your literature books, while you're reading any newspaper article, talking to somebody, take a noun phrase out of that context and try to fit it in and analyze that noun phrase. just as a summary, pronouns used occur alone, sometimes as an identifier, sometimes as an adjective, and sometimes they can be held by a word modifier.
Nothing new in here, it's just a repetition of the same thing that we were saying.
Any questions about that? Would you like to answer one of the activities on that? Let's look at that. Put the parts of the noun phrases below into the correct order. As you do this, think about how you make your decision. In the next activity, you will see these noun phrases in context. Family, it's third festival. It's third family festival. Why did you say third? Why did you organize it as such? I mean, we know the language, so we can hear the language. But if you wanted to be technical about it, we're looking at a determiner, a pre-modifier, third family, but the adjective element of it is first, the noun element of it second. So first thing you did, you identified the head. You identified the head and then everything else fits based on meaning. So this is a very straightforward exercise. Look at this activity here. You can see the noun phrases in context and align the parts of each noun phrase. Click on the buttons below. Let's take the first sentence, actually. Milton Keynes celebrates its third family festival this week with exciting musical performances from a host of bands and choirs. Now, they've done half of the job. They've identified the noun phrases for you in bold. They told you that its third family festival is a noun phrase. Now, Milton Keynes on its own is a noun phrase, but it's just a noun. So there's nothing to do with it. It's the name of the town. Its third family festival, what do you have? Determiner. Pre-modifier adjective. With the head family. Is family the head? It's the festival we're talking about now. Our main noun, our subject is, or our object actually, because this is an object noun phrase. Our object is the festival. Milton Keynes celebrates not its family, but it celebrates its festival. Now we're modifying the festival. So the head is actually the festival, and then family is the fourth modifier. I'm sorry. Exciting musical performances from a host of bands and choirs. Pre-modifier adjective. Again. Performances we had now. From a host of bands and choirs. Here we're talking about a post modifier. All right. So you know how it goes. I mean, you're supposed to know the name basically. You're supposed to know the titles. You can say it as an English sentence. You can say it as an English phrase. But you need to identify which element is called what. And it is helpful to know, to start by identifying the head of your noun phrase, and then you can figure out the rest of the elements. A finite verb needs to agree with its subject. We go back to finite because it has a tense, it's a verb that has a function, and it is the head of the subject noun phrase which determines whether the verb should be singular or plural. Now this is a reminder, this is an explanation. Your exam questions or any other activities will not have that much information, background information. This is just to remind you. Look at the verbs in italics and the paragraphs below. Find the subject of each of these verbs and click on the head. Increasingly, the acceptance of certain standards, such as for the audio cassette in the 1960s and the compact disc in the 1980s, have helped manufacturers to avoid wasteful duplication. What is your head now? Is it? Acceptance. Increasingly, the acceptance of certain standards. So the acceptance of certain standards, is a post modifier. So if I identify this as my head noun, acceptance of certain standards, and then such as is just an example. What is the verb? Has, because it agrees with the singular subject. The next activity is read through the following pages and think about questions as you go along. Click the button when you are ready to see the suggested answer. Compare the two sentences below. Although they look similar, they have very different interpretations. How would you explain the difference? She opened the window in her bathroom. She opened the window in her attic. Now, what is the difference? We have classified them. Can you classify these two nouns? Can you group, divide it into a group, a constituent group? She opened the window in her bathroom. What kind of questions can you ask about this sentence? What did she open? And how did she open the window? How did she open the window? Okay, the next one. She opened the window in her attic. Attic is the room above a room in your house. The TV. Which window or where is the window? Where is the window? Which window did she open? Okay, so in the attic is describing what? Is modifying what? What is it modifying? Which noun? The window. And in her bathrobe is modifying which noun? She. It's modifying the she, the pronoun. So that's the difference. I have a subject, I have a verb, I have an object, and I have a prepositional phrase, or I have a descriptive prepositional phrase. In one case, it's a how, or how did she open it? How was she when she opened it? Actually, not how did she open it, how was she when she opened it? And the next one, which window did she open? So because I'm asking different questions, I'm addressing different nouns here, the prepositional phrase is actually a force-modified different noun here. So, in her bathroom, this is a force-modifier for which noun? For which head? For she. And the next one, it's a force-modifier for window. Right, so you have a lot of other questions that you can look at. Continue with these activities, please, because they are useful and it triggers your mind on thinking about why is this very, very useful? Put aside grammar and identifying noun phrases and classifying them and all of that. When you write, if you cannot get it straight, what are you modifying? Then your reader can get very confused and it can be a very ambiguous sentence. You're trying to say something is silly, you end up saying something else is silly because the way you place your adjective silly in the paragraph in the clause, the way you place your prepositional phrase, the way you place your relative clause, or definitely your participle, you just want them then and modify the participle, the waiting for, or the broken, or chosen. If you don't place it in the right position in the sentence, you might create a totally different meaning, sometimes an offending meaning, sometimes a totally misleading meaning. So keep track of these things, think about them in your own writing, which is what matters the most at this point. Now, interestingly, chapter 11 talks about modality. Now, modality, chapter 11 actually is very, very straightforward and simple chapter. It has a lot of examples in the chapter, but it doesn't go into too much detail except about the type of modality. Now, what is modality? What are models? May, might, what, should, can, can, could. Okay, if I say this is a person, do you have any reason to argue a case against me or question my statement? This is a person. We are in class. Not really. She was the person. Okay. Maybe I say, she may like the school. She may not like the school. Possibility. There's a possibility. There's a likelihood that somebody is absent. She must be safe. I have very good clues, very good reasons, very good
point of that today. So there's a likelihood, there's a possibility. Our US model expressed that concept of possibility, that concept of likelihood, when a statement is not a factual statement. And when we say factual, it means it's study a fact. Now facts don't have to be scientific facts like water boils at 100 degrees, but simple facts like this is a band, there are many students in this class, these are factual statements. So there, we call them their assertion. I'm just making an assertion. It's live on that day. It's on that day. She might not say. She loves this woman. She enjoys the sport. She will enjoy the sport. I'm not sure. There's a possibility she may enjoy it and another possibility that she may not. So our using modality, number one reason for using modality, this is why we have something. When I have known the fact to a statement, to talk about something that is possible or likely. I'm making a conclusion or induction based on evidence, but it's something that's possible or not. And one of the reasons I could use modality is to say, to talk about necessity or to talk about desirability. So instead of saying, she will come to class, I say she should come to class. She has to come to class. She must come to class. What's the meaning of she must come to class? Obligation, necessity. She has an exam. She must go to room at W106. She must do that because there's an assessment for it. She must come and visit us before she leaves the country. I'd like her. I mean, there's an necessity, but it's an emotional necessity. It's a desirability. So basically, I have these two sides of modality. One that talks about possibility or likelihood, and another talks about something that's possible or likely, and another that talks about something that is necessary or desirable. When we talk about possibility or likelihood, we're talking about what we call epistemic modality. And when we talk about something that's necessary or desirable, we're talking about the noetic modality. If I'm saying the chapter is done, do you believe that? I mean, pretty much. There are other small details, other minute, more subtle things that are attached to that come out of this, but basically this is the chapter. This is what we're trying to implement in this chapter. We're trying to say, and this happens when I don't, when I'm not making the assertions, when I'm not talking about facts, when I have a reason to qualify my facts. If I say, I locked the door, I locked the house door, or I say, I'm sure I locked the door.
How far we regard it as likely or possible,
or as desirable and necessary.
This is as simple as that. We're talking with it's a resource, it's a language resource, it's a tool within the English language that allows us to refer to such instances where we're talking about non-factual information.
Some sentences in English are bare assertions. That is, they say that something is the case, factual. You need yeast and flour to make bread.
You're not going to argue. You're not going to say, really? Or, are you sure, maybe? You need yeast and flour. You know, I locked the door. This is a table. There are 20 people in this room. These are bare assertions.
In some sentences, the speaker makes logical deductions, conclusions, relating to the speaker's assessment of whether something is likely or possible, a systemic modality, for example. If I say, and that's the book's example, if I say Shakespeare's plays are written by Francis Bacon, that's not a bad assertion. Some people agree to that and some people don't agree to that. So I'm going to add in a model, which is may have been written. I'm going to add the model that indicates possibility or likelihood. There might be like the Mars crisis could fall next year. Or I can use modality to suggest that it would be desirable or necessary for a certain action to be taken. She must be good at Spanish. Okay? She must come and see us before she goes. Everyone should save energy. That's a necessity. Everyone should save energy. Now take these two sentences, and these two sentences use the same model, but they indicate different modalities. She must be good at Spanish. She must be sick today. Oh, here I'm saying it's very natural that she is. It's an epistemic modality. I'm concluding that she is sick, but I'm not sure, I cannot confirm, I can't say she is sick. Here she must come and see us. She has to, necessarily, we want it so much, desirable that she comes. So the same model, must and must, can be used for two sentences. He can lift, he could lift the 10 kilo gram bar. He could do it. He could come tomorrow. That's me. So there's a set. I'm using the model sometimes for a state of fact, sometimes for a systemic modality, sometimes for a genetic modality. It's very important that you know the difference between likelihood and possibility as opposed to desirability and effect. Okay? Any worries about that? It's straightforward. It's there. Now, Chapter 12, again, is as straightforward as that, and it's related, though, to when we talked about sense, when we talked about meaning, when we talked about the relationships of meaning, idioms, words that go together. We're not talking about idioms here, but we're talking about words and grammar together. If I say the window is too open, is that a regular English sentence? The window is too open. We don't say too open. She left me to use her stapler. Anything wrong with that? She left me to use her stapler. We have to drop two. Why do many non-native speakers of English, many non-native speakers of English say left me to use? What do you think? Any guesses? She allows me to use it. She lets me use it. We say, let me to use. Like she allows me, she forces me, all these forces to, asks me to, permits me to. And then let is different. So, let is a verb. And we're talking about something that is a permission between this person and another person. But when I use let, I don't use to. The window is too open. I can say she's too open-minded. Or she's too open, meaning she doesn't care about her private issues. She doesn't mind being public.
She's so open. Well, I'm not saying the window is too open. I'm saying the window is open too far or too wide. I'm saying something else.
They presented the runner-up as a cash prize. They presented him with a cash prize, or they gave him a cash prize. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about a certain grammatical structure that says, I have a subject, they, I have a verb presented, I have an object, and I have an indirect object or a prepositional phrase. Depends on what word I'm using, the grammatical structure will vary. Some structures are acceptable with certain words, and the same structures will not be acceptable with similar grammatical, with words that are grammatically similar, nouns, or prepositions, or verbs, or So what are we talking about here? We're talking about something that the grammarians or the linguists would like to call lexical grammar. What is lexical grammar? It's a field of study that studies the combination and the connection between vocabulary, lexicon, and grammar. So I cannot apply the rule of grammar across the board of all words. I need to pay attention to one word from somewhere and another word from somewhere. Now, it happens a lot that non-native speakers would fall into such errors because what they do, how do usually non-native speakers who learn a language at school, you know the rules and you try to generalize the rules. But when you generalize the rules, it so happens that in language there are only exceptions to the rules. And it has to do with practice, it has to do with knowledge of how this particular word functions in its native context, so you make some errors with that. So lexical grammar, and of course it happens with native speakers as well, but lexical grammar is basically a recognition of the difficulty of keeping lexis and grammar separate, and an attempt to look instead at the way they work together in what now has been called lexical grammar. Now, how does it function? What do they depend on to see the rules of lexical grammar, to find out patterns of lexical grammar? It has become much easier now to figure out such conventions of which word is mixed with what and how is each word used by the presence and the availability of the electronic resources, the electronic databases now, what is called course of study. You have electronic databases that accumulate and that list and gives you access to millions. Millions of expressions from real life, from German, from usually written, sometimes now they're doing spoken, but you have to know what people say, what people have written in newspapers, what literature, what has been written in novels, and you see, when I just find the word too, when I find it is too open, and when I find it is too open, is it related to objects, the door is too open, windows are too open, or is it related only to personalities, to people who are too open? So I just study in course of study, I look at these databases and I see the occurrence of two orders and I notice that never used or hardly ever used with an object. I don't talk about bags that are too open, windows that are too open, doors that are too open. So the availability of the electronic resources, we can now know that what is the proper way? What is the native way? What is the conventional way? What is the acceptable way? This is, again, all there is in terms of chapter 12. The two examples, the electronic corpus that has become available, actually it started, the two main electronic sources that started were the Codal Dictionary and the Codal Grammar. One was established in 1976, started the Liga, and then you have the Codal Grammar. Business English that is used in Germany and how it differs from business English that is used in England and what influence of the German language comes into the book of English in Germany. Because you make, there are certain different conventions that grow in a certain area because of the influence of the native language, for example, dialect and how dialects are formed. So you can study these patterns. You can say, okay, a lot of other speakers say,
Midterm is until chapter 13. From chapter 1 to chapter 13, that's it, in the linguistic toolkit.